I would like to start with you with one question. In the first panel, we saw a few best practice examples, like from Scotland, from Flanders, from Denmark, where there is a state or governmental architect, so it is one person. Now we heard several examples of advisory boards, of advisory committees, where there are more independent persons working on a decision. What is the advantage and what is the disadvantage of one person and of a group of persons? Who would like to start? Because Josef Matthies, you also mentioned that it still has to be the mayor who's the one to decide. It still is the human being who's taking care of architecture and building quality. So what is the difference, what is the advantage and disadvantage of one person and of a group? Everybody's got a microphone.
Okay, I will try. First, the group, I think that's obvious, gives a kind of objectivity by the, it's a kind of a collective, collegial organ to come to make up the mind. And it's at the minimum a compromise, and in the best case, just an agreement. I think if it's the question with the one person, this is very delicate. And what we learned in comparing cities is that one person, for example, could find its his or her role in asking the right questions and in inviting the right people to bring in the expertise and not to do everything. Just as Mayor Matthies said, that the mayor is somebody who makes things possible, is a kind of an inviter. And this can be a very powerful position, actually, to use this position as the inviter, the one who makes it possible. And I think in Innsbruck it is so successful, actually, as the level of town planning asks questions. In other cities I experienced, they give answers, and we in the board try to correct the answers. But the questions, even more, sometimes the questions are the thing to be found, actually, because there is something in the air and you have hardly words for it. And then the goal or the target is, what is it about and how can we call it by name and how can we communicate it? And that's the dimension where even one person can contribute very intensively.
Thank you. Gerhard, for just a second, because I would also like to include Josef Matthies to this. So if I understood it correctly, if you have one person, that's the correct person to ask the questions, and the committee or the board is the group to give you the answers. Wie funktioniert das in Zwischenwasser? Sie haben mir gesagt, es soll Chefsache bleiben. Das heißt, ist der Bürgermeister derjenige, der die Fragen stellt? Ist der Gestaltungsbeirat derjenige, der die Antworten gibt? Deutsch, Englisch, ich übersetze.
Ja, der Bürgermeister stellt die Fragen, aber bevor der Bürgermeister die Fragen stellt, muss er sich auch thematisch mit den Dingen befassen. Sonst macht das keinen Sinn. Und ich meinte vorher, mit der Bürgermeister ist er möglicher. Also er muss die Dinge ermöglichen, er muss nicht alles selber tun. Und im Laufe der Zeit kriegt man dann als Bürgermeister, auch wenn man keine Ausbildung in Architektur oder Gestaltung hat, ein gewisses Gefühl. Also es sagt einem schon, ja, das könnte in die richtige Richtung gehen. Und dann ist die Fragestellung natürlich an der Tagesordnung, ja.
So even though the mayor is not the architect, the mayor is not a regional planner, it is a person who has to have a certain interest and it is a person who has to have a certain feeling for the material. So the mayor has to be the person who wants to do this and who wants to get into contact and communication with the advisory board. Gerhard Fritz.
I couldn't judge if a one-person system or an advisory board system is better, since I only know the board system. For me, what is important is the commitment on behalf, on the part of the political side, that we have certain ideas what quality consists of, that we need experts' advice to arrive at quality, that we are willing to listen to the experts and to create a free space for discussion among the experts before we decide. It's this commitment that's important, and not the system, if it's a board of four people or of six people or just one regional Baumeister like the one from Flammen that I heard at the Turn On festival in Vienna.
The Flemish Baumeister. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, what questions do you have to the panel? So, a few. I would suggest we'll collect 2-3 questions. I'll take notes, and then we'll put all of the questions to the panel. Georg.
I don't have a question. I want just to say something. You had the question, the moderator, Wojtek had the question about the comparison of the one man or the committee. And I think I took a photo of one of the slides of Mr. Sternholm, and this was his playground. And there are words like workshop, dialogue, information, citizen, press, artist, guided tours. It seems, and I find this a wonderful idea, that this is a very proactive position, and it has a lot to do with communication with the people, with the citizens, and perhaps I assume also with the architect. It has less to do with assessing the quality of projects in a way, whereas this concept is purely, and he is very proactive, obviously, his role, whereas our system is rather reactive. And of course, this is now a bit internal. Innsbruck lacks enormously information transparency. It's a bit a closed gate around the experts, and this is not in the case, of course, for Mr. Matti. He, in my view, has rather the role of the communicator as well. So it's always, of course, these things are very different, but I think this is a very major difference between the committee structure, which is a very internal expert thing, and the proactive individual city architect. Thank you.
So it's proactivity, it's guided tours, it's app. Again, we're talking about communication, which seems to be a very important issue. Second question.
I want to come back to the image of Ernst Banneder saying that planning our towns are like movies. Our towns are like movies, but all legal frames are written down and they are fixed in images. And we see a lot of lawyers waiting to find some lacks in all our written documents. And I would like to see how you can manage with the Beirat to give some instruments and some indications to overpass those regulations that are fixed, and to give the mayor the possibility to make a project with qualities that overpasses the regulations, and not to be exposed directly to lawyers saying my building could be built in the framework. More and more we see that our general plans are fixed, and you with the Beirat are playing on another playground as a movie, as you said just before.
How would you, may I ask you, how would you ask your question in just a very short sentence? Please help us.
The playground between fixed legal framework with the Beirat.
Thank you. So let's come back to the questions, and I'll be coming back to you in a minute. There, we have a question in the first row. We even have two questions.
I think it goes a little bit in the same direction, because you were talking, Ernst Benedict, about the urban scale, about the space in between, and in Germany we are discussing a lot about the Gestaltungsbeiräte, Design Advisory Boards, if there is any possibility to get them earlier into the process, that they don't only judge about single projects, but they also advise in the scale of urban planning, because very often in the scale of urban planning, there's already starting the problem, and then you try to fix a single project, but I mean, it's more on the urban scale where the problem is lying. So what are your experience about that? Is there any possibility to get the design advisory board earlier into the process?
Thank you. But then we have another question. Don't be afraid, I'm taking notes. Everything is fine, I'll repeat it.
My question will go to a completely different direction from what has been talked. At one point, Mr. Fritz had mentioned it's very important that the built environment, the quality is dependent on the sustainability, usability, functionality of the social space, social dimensions, and not about the beauty or the aesthetics. But the Baukunst and the building activity can never be taught without the dimensions of aesthetics and ethics. Now, without reducing aesthetics to a question or discussion of taste, I would be very much interested to hear from the Fachexpert and also from the politician how to deal with these two dimensions, which are not in the mode anymore. We don't discuss about these things, but we are human beings, social beings, who also have values and aesthetical and ethical function of building. How does that come together?
Thank you. So we have a good program to work on. The first question, let's fix on that. How can this playground, how can this play between a fixed legal framework and an advisory board or advisory committee work? Wie kann die Zusammenarbeit ausschauen zwischen einem Gesetz, zwischen einer ganz klaren Sache und einer dynamischen Zusammenarbeit eines Beirats? Who would like to start?
Okay, I'll make it short. So if the regulation allows itself to change the regulation, then it's up to the user to take advantage of that fact. And the Councillor Fritz has explained it. In Innsbruck, there's this pressure for densification, and you give the chance to the investor, you can do something, and you get better regulations, and you try to find, together with the competition, with the board, to find the best solution for the site, and then you adjust the regulations. In other cities, only to compare, I'm also in the city of Graz. In Graz, the administration would do the regulation, then comes the investor, the project, and the board suffers that we would have, there would so much potential in the site, in the project, and it's not allowed anymore because the regulation says here is stop and here is the line and don't go beyond. And that's the, say, the courage they have here in Innsbruck, which is so striking, stunning, and so motivating. And the word was taken to, was used today, that was the fun and the pleasure and the excitement to work here in Innsbruck. And this is a chance once more on a panel to thank those who made it possible.
The watch is lying here. Uh-huh. We still have just a few minutes. May I also include Josef Mattis and Gerhard Fritz to this question? How can you design this playground between legal framework and advisory board? Josef.
Ja, das kommt auch darauf an, welche Regeln und Vorschriften es gibt. In Vorarlberg beispielsweise ist das Baugesetz relativ liberal gehalten, aber was die Ortsgestaltung betrifft, gibt es einen klaren, klar definierten Absatz. Da heißt es, dass das Bauvorhaben hinsichtlich gestalterischer Qualität, Ortseinbindung und so weiter zu prüfen ist. Das ist eine gute Vorgabe. Die Interpretation ist natürlich etwas anderes und da kommt der Gestaltungsbeirat ins Spiel und wir haben bei uns Kriterien, etwa 7 oder 8 Kriterien, nach welchen die Bewertung erfolgt, festgeschrieben. Das kriegt der Bauwerber vorher und dann weiß er auch, nach was beurteilt wird. Und die, wie gesagt, die Interpretation ist eine Sache des Gestaltungsbeirates. Aber grundsätzlich glaube ich, weniger Vorschriften ist besser, dann ist die Gestaltungsmöglichkeit größer. Aber man braucht dazu ein Gespräch auf Augenhöhe zwischen Investor, Bauherr und Architekten des Gestaltungsbeirates. Das ist auch manchmal schwierig, aber es hat sich viel.
Ja. So, it's an issue between the building law, which at least it's this way in Austria, is very different in every province. In the case of the province of Vorarlberg, you have a rather liberal architecture law and a rather strict regional planning law, but still at the end of the day it's about communication and also it's about interpretation of the advisory committee, how to interpret special legal issues. Important to be able to do that is to fix criteria and to work with those criteria. Gerhard Fritz?
Well,
we're still if you don't, short if, answer on the playground.
If you don't quote me on that, we all know that investors have good lawyers and they're finding all the loopholes in the existing regulations. So why shouldn't a city administration also try to find the loopholes when it comes to upholding the public interest and quality? And what we say is dying of fear means you are dead anyway.
Thank you. Lucky you that today I'm a chairman here and a facilitator and not a journalist, so I'm not going to quote you. Second question. Ernst Beneda, that was, I think, a question to you. How can an advisory board get earlier into a process, so not only talk about yes, good design, or no, not such a good design?
Well, it's the atmosphere in the particular city. Like here in Innsbruck, we have recognized there is the need of this discussion, like that suburb of Wilton. There was no particular project, but there were two or three workshops for a day or two just to discuss the development of the complete quarter, and then we are prepared and ready for the particular project that is coming. So if there would be only the singular project, you would say, okay, within these single family houses, stay in scale. But now we know in the next 20 or 30 years, there will be a urban development.
Thank you. And the last question I would like Gerhard Fritz and Josef Mattis to answer. Thank you for this aesthetics and ethic question. So we're not only talking about regional planning, we're not only talking about criteria, but still at the end of the day, when we talk about architecture and quality in urban spaces, we talk about beauty, about aesthetics, and about ethics. Where exactly do you find space for that? Wo in all dieser Diskussion über Raumplanung, über Gesetze, über Qualität ist am Ende noch Platz für Ästhetik und für Ethik? Gerhard Fritz, would you like to start?
Well, I think beauty is not the same as being pleasant. With some education you can recognize beauty or aesthetic quality even if you personally find it unpleasant. Like, for me, I can recognize good Baroque architecture even if I detest Baroque. That's sort of, you need a certain level of education to be able to do that. And the most important thing is you are never alone, not even as a politician. The process is what's important. I've experienced in many juries and in sessions with the Gestaltungsbeirat, the discussion comes to some kind of conclusion that has some kind of objectivity, even if it's still the sum of subjective positions of the single members. But on the whole, as a collective, you arrive at conclusions that usually sort of stand up to reality.
Thank you. I think you will have to meet each other in lunch break and talk about Baroque and about process quality. Josef Mattis, wie kann man auch für Ästhetik und für ethische Qualität sorgen?
Ja, indem man weniger Regeln hat und mehr Platz für Ästhetik. Und grundsätzlich denke ich, das Thema Bauernbaukultur ist ein Diskussionsprozess, der über viele Jahre braucht, um erfolgreich zu sein. Also das ist etwas, das kann man nicht so mit Schalter umlegen, sondern das ist ein Prozess, den man kontinuierlich bearbeiten muss und dann ist er auch erfolgreich.
Dankeschön. So, less law, if I may put it into a nutshell, and more communication and more freedom for interpretation. Coming to the lunch break, I will ask you for one final answer. And I would like to give us one sentence each. Gerhard Fritz, I will start with you and we'll go to this round. We're talking about legal issues today. We're talking about how to bring architecture quality into also into a lex, into a legal framework. My question to you is, if it was up to you, if you had to choose, what would be the first and most important sentence in this preamble or in this architecture and regional planning law? Was wäre, wenn es Ihre Entscheidung wäre, eine Präambel zu schreiben oder ein Gesetz zu schreiben, der erste und der wichtigste Satz in dieser Präambel? So, one sentence.
Since you are going to change the built environment, do the best you can and make the world a little bit better.
Thank you. Ernst Beneda.
Make a diagram of the problem and it will be the solution.
Thank you. Josef Mattis.
Baukultur machen Menschen wie du und ich.
Built environment, Baukultur is done by people like you and me. Thank you very much. Three different people, three different approaches.